ourselves. So I was born and raised in Wisconsin, and my parents were divorced when I was about 2 years old, so I have no recollection of them being together as a family. I wasn't raised in a particularly religious family. I was my dad and my paternal grandmother raised me in Milwaukee, and so we would go to church sometimes. In fact, my dad would sometimes take me to Sunday school and drop me off and then go to the coffee shop and read the paper. And I just thought, you know, that's what, you know, kids went to church sometimes and parents didn't, or to Sunday school anyway, and we rarely went to worship. My mom stayed in the Milwaukee area. She was a really cool lady, very creative, very bright. She was in advertising in the 60s, was creative director of an advertising agency, wonderful, fun, loving lady. But she was an alcoholic. If you've watched Ad Men, that was kind of very much the norm in advertising in those days. So when I was in middle school, my mom's life began to kind of unravel as a result of the alcoholism. And I was an only child, so I'm very close to both my parents. But that was a really tough time for me. And that was that, watching my mom's life begin to come unglued, really drew me to wanting something stable that I could hang on to. And that was during the Jesus freak era. And so I had some wild and crazy friends that met in the basement and played guitar and studied the Bible. And that was my first encounter with, to me, what felt like a vibrant Christian faith. Although I believe now that little Sunday school teachers way back when were the ones who planted the seed, that it occurred to me to turn in that direction. So became, you know, very committed Christian. That was actually, I think, kind of my way of rebelling against my family. They were worried about me. You know, let's not take this religious thing too far, honey. When it was time to go to college, I went as far away as I could from my family of origin, because I was sure my mom would just come and, you know, want to embarrass me. And so I came to school to Texas from Wisconsin. Came to school in Dallas. And the summer after my freshman year in college, my mom passed away, just basically as a result of the toll on her body from years of abuse. When I went to SMU, I was really excited to find a church home. I never had really found a church home, and I knew one thing: it was not going to be Presbyterian, because the little church that I went to in Milwaukee as a young child was a downtown Presbyterian church with lots of old people, and it just wasn't very cool. And so I was going to find this, you know, great church. Well, my second week in college, somebody took me for the Presbyterian church located right by SMU. And it was an alive church with lots of young adults and lots of college students, and I loved it. And so in college, my commitment to Christ grew, but also my appreciation for the Presbyterian church and the way we do things grew in college. And that's why I love to teach what I teach today, because two of the things I think that make Presbyterianism so wonderful are the intentionality with which we worship and the way we govern ourselves. So I began to, lo and behold, in spite of myself, come to appreciate that in college. I didn't know what I wanted to do vocationally, thought about missions. Actually, I was a foreign language major in college. I volunteered with the youth group there at that church, and so when I graduated, I kind of, because I didn't know what I wanted to do, they had an internship doing youth ministry, and I thought, oh, I'll just do that for 15 months while I figure out what I really want to do with my life. Well, I stumbled upon a love. So I did, after I finished my internship there in high school ministry, I went to a church in Houston and was the youth director there for 7 or 8 years. Met my husband there. He was a volunteer with the youth group, with the junior hires, which if you get to know my husband, which you will at some point, that is so not him. And that was a God thing for sure, that God likes it. You are going to work with the junior hires. And he's like, okay. So we were friends, probably with a great group of young people that worked with the youth, and then fell in love and married, and the junior high choir sang in our wedding from First Pres. And then his work took us back to Dallas, and I started doing campus ministry back at the church that I had worked at right out of college. So I was doing the very college ministry that I had done when I was in school, and loved working with college students. Throughout all of this time, I was feeling, in fact, when I graduated from college, I almost went to seminary, but I just felt like, I'm not sure I want to do school, and I certainly don't, want to ask my family to pay for more schooling, and so I just, and at that point, I really wasn't positive that women should be pastors, actually. But throughout all of this, we had two kids, one son in 1990, one in 92, this just really call to ordained pastorate just kept growing. And so finally in about 2000, a friend and I were just kind of talking about our lives, and he said, "Mallie, you're not getting any younger. If you're going to do this seminary thing, you need to just do it." So Chuck and I went away for a weekend, my husband and I, and kind of prayed, because we were living in a manse of this church in University Park. So no mortgage, no rent. People came and did our yard work. I walked across the street with the two little boys. They went to the day. I mean, it was a cushy setup, let me just say. It was great. And I love my job. But we decided we were not going to ignore this call. So my husband moved into an efficiency apartment, and he kept his job in Dallas. He's an attorney in downtown Dallas. The boys and I moved into student housing in Austin, and we did that for 4 years, where every weekend my husband commuted to be with his family. Such a huge gift that enabled me to go to seminary. And so when we got out, we got this call from this crazy church in McKinney, and I came and interviewed here and accepted the position. I'm the first associate pastor this church has ever had. Patrick had been working on his own for 12 years or so, I think, before I came. So it was great, guys, because there was nobody to compare me to. And Patrick was so happy to have help that, it was a great situation, once again, to stumble into. So I have been here since 2005. Love working with Patrick. Wonderful staff. Such a gift. My dad never remarried, and he came to live with us our last year in Austin. So that would have been 2004. And he's still with us at 92. So he's in our home with us. You'll see him tottering about, still drives. But I think one of the greatest gifts this church gave to me personally is Dad, 3 years ago this March, decided to be baptized, and Patrick baptized me. So if anybody ever tells you, it's too late, people can't change, at 90, my father was baptized, and this is the first church that he has ever been a member of in his entire life. So nothing could make my heart happier. So both the boys are grown and out of the house. Chuck is still schlepping up and down 75 going to work in downtown Dallas. He got the short end of the stick again in the commute department. But I just feel so very gifted to be here. And there are so many beautiful people that are members of the congregation here and on staff. It's just been such a gift. I just can't believe people pay me to have so much fun. So that's just a little bit about my background. I do try to share that. Pretty about the alcoholic background, because I think there are many of us who come from a background like that, and I think it's important to know and just have that connection. So I wanted to share that with you. All right, well, let's get started on Presbyterian worship. So you should have at your place or possibly on the end one sheet that looks like a sheet that looks like this, if you can pass them down your, and then there also should be some bulletins. So make sure that each of you has one of those. They should be right. They're going to come. Don't worry. No, they're you can get them down there, I think. Everybody have access to one of these and one of these? Not, I've got more. Oops, sorry. By the way, there are some folks who weren't here last week.
Yeah.
Let's go around and just say our name that way we can work on just get, you know, putting names and faces together. So let's start back there with Jen.
Oh, Jen Zaccarella. I'm a deacon helping with this class, not attending the class.
I'm Leslie Vessel. I'm a deacon for Member Connections. Natalie White, deacon for Member Connections as well.
All right, Kenneth.
Ken Klaus, moved here from Lubbock last year.
Wonderful. Glad you're here.
Oh, sorry. Ann Rice, I moved back to Texas from California this summer.
Liz Hammerhan, moved here recently from Vermont.
Jeff Hammerhan, husband of Liz Hammerhan.
Lynette Green, we moved to McKinney a little over a year ago.
I'm Tracy Green, her other half. I wouldn't say better.
I'm Steve Neinmeyer. We are kind of native to the area.
Joe Neinmeyer.
Great. We'll go back to you, Bobby.
Bob Howell, the evangelism.
Lance Covington. I'm new to McKinney as of a year and almost a year and a half. Mm-hmm. Married to Chelsea.
Yes. I'm Chelsea Covington. I've actually grown up in the church in Mallee, Meredith, so.
And she was out of your college. She was deathly ill with the flu last Sunday, so we're glad you're among the land of the living this week. And behind you?
Sharon Montgomery.
I'm a part of this class. Helped to facilitate.
I'm Tammy Behrman, and we moved here June, wasn't it?
June 24th.
He's got it right on the dot, doesn't he? We're over at the old folks' home, and we moved here actually to be closer to our daughter because we've both been sick, we both had cancer, and we just found we couldn't work with the house anymore, so we sold our house and moved here.
Tough decision, but we are so thankful that you both are here.
Thank you.
So thankful. And Chuck, of course.
Well, needless to say, I belong to her. And it's happened because I knew two words. Yes, dear.
What a smart man. Well, good.
But we're glad to be here.
As Rebecca mentioned, it's really our hope that it, in addition to the information that sort of gets fire hydranted into you, that also you get to know one another. So we do want to take that time. It's important. All right, so let's talk a little bit.
Andy.
Oh, I'm sorry, Andy. I'm sorry.
Not going to offend me. Andy Wilson. I'm from Nacogdoches. I moved up here a year and a half. Go married Paige Allenson, Joan Allenson's daughter, and so I teach 8th grade boys during logos on Wednesday nights here. So
great, thank you, Andy. All right, well, if everybody has one of these sheets, that'll be our basic thing we're working off of. Now, we're going to be focusing most of our conversation about worship this morning on corporate worship, but I do want to broaden our understanding of worship a little bit to begin. So boo, you may be wondering what the heck boo is. Do we have any lifelong Presbyterians who have a guess of what boo might be? When we talk about our the way we govern ourselves, I'll share with you our Constitution. The first book in our Constitution is the Book of Order. And I'm too lazy to write out Book of Order over and over again, so it is abbreviated in my world to boo. So these are some quotes from our Constitution. Would someone like to read aloud the first quote there? Anybody?
I'll read it.
Great, thanks, Chuck.
Through worship, people attend to the presence of God in their life. From a Christian's life in the world comes the need for worship. In worship, one sees the world in light of God's grace. From worship come vision and power for living in the world. The rhythm of the life of the believer moves from worship to ministry, from ministry to worship.
Thank you.
Boo.
Thank you, Jeff. So as we go out into the world, we get buffeted about sometimes, so we come back into worship to be nurtured, to have a sense of being reformed, reclaimed, and then we don't just stay in our little worship cocoon here, you know, afraid of the world, and not, we go back out in the world. So it's a constant rhythm. And that's what worship enables us to do, to live the lives we were intended. But personal worship, in other words, 1 hour a week is not going to cut it if we really are wanting to be transformed into the likeness of Christ, to live the kind of life that God would have us live. So there's also an element of our worship that we've encouraged you to do in the gifting of the Schnazy book with the daily devotional, some form of daily intentional connection with God. And so I want to read a quote again from our Constitution on that. The daily challenge of discipleship requires the daily nurture of worship. The life of a Christian empowered by grace is expressed in obedience and is shaped by discipline. In daily personal worship, we find the times and places where we can focus on God's presence, hear God's word, and respond to God's grace in prayer, self-offering, and commitment to service. Very much in line with our sermon this morning, commitment to serve. I don't know about y'all, but I have recently become aware that I am getting way too attached to my cell phone. I am spending way too much time scrolling through Facebook, reading posts about the state of the world and politics, and it is just not the highest and best use of my time. Not that I'm advocating sticking our head in the sand and not being aware of what's going on in the world, but I am really personally feeling a call back into being so intentional about that daily connectedness with God. So I don't know if anyone else struggles with it. I'll tell you, even pastors do, and just, you know, have to be reminded of that. But again, our focus today will be on corporate worship more so, but I, you know, Andy, would you read that quote on corporate worship there?
The life of the Christian flows from the worship of the church, where identity as a believer is confirmed and where one is commissioned to a life of discipleship and of personal response to God.
Right, so our lives is a response to a response to God's initiative, God's love for us. All right, so we're going to talk about what is your role in worship. And I want to do this in kind of an unusual way. We're going to talk first about the common understanding, and then we're going to contrast that with, hey, Alex, come in.
Sorry.
That, no problem. This is my friend Alex Cochran, and he was ill last week, too. And he is so glad you are here. Can you give him a shout out? This is one of those ones. We're talking about worship, Alex, and you'll catch on. We're at this funky little diagram, mid-first page there. So if we were to liken worship to a theater performance, because if you think about our great hall, it's kind of set up like a theater, isn't it? There's, you know, got the audience and the stage and all that. So if we were to liken worship to a theater performance, who do you suppose the actors would be? Who are the actors?
Ministers, choir.
Ministers, choir, song leader. Well, right, good. So good. That would be the common thing. So if you're a nerd, you can write under the common thing that the actors would be the pastors, the choir, soloists. Okay, prompters. Who might be the prompters? Any idea on that one? How about Jennifer, our song leader, right? Isn't she sort of prompting the congregation to sing? Those would be the prompters. And who's the audience?
Congregation,
right? Okay. Right? That's pretty logical, isn't it? However, that is not the Presbyterian understanding of worship. So I want to turn this, I hope, turn your understanding of worship on its head from now, from this morning, for the rest of your lives.
Mally,
yes.
Could I say something along that line?
Yes.
Recognize these three Presbyterian dictates, if you will, or explanations, but Tammy and I, we've been Presbyterians for years, although I started out as a Catholic. We were RVers for a long time. We tried full-time on the road with the motorhome and all that stuff. But it was rather interesting because all these things impacted our lives, because after a while, we were worshiping in God's cathedral, because you can't do that every Sunday. Most people can't. and some of the stuff that's out there, just the scenery, is absolutely phenomenal. And we didn't do it. God did it, you know. And so we were really feeling the impact of that. But somehow, some way, it began to come across, we missed the, if you will, the daily medication of others who believed the same way, who were questioning how the Bible would be, you know, it was interpreted for your daily life. And this all became, you know, back, and that's another reason that we're here at Trinity. This kind of came back to us, and which, of course, here we can't do anything. We can't get in and out of a trailer or a motorhome anymore, so it doesn't make any difference. But it did force us back into that relationship with others.
That's a really excellent point, Chuck, that we are created to live in community. It says in Genesis, it's not good to be alone. And as far as our spirituality, that's actually a really important value that you'll see come up as I talk this morning, that Presbyterians focus on that need for community. Scripture talks about iron sharpening iron, and there are just so many things about the importance of being together. And I think that's a little bit countercultural, because our American rugged individualism tells us, you know, and there's this whole emphasis of I'm spiritual but not religious. And I respect that. I get it. The organized church has done a lot to cause people to not have a lot of trust in us, but I still maintain that we were created to need each other if we are serious about becoming all that God created us to be. Hey, guys, come in. Or guys, come in. No, come in. We have several solo guys here today.
Now my wife is Buffing Daniels.
So. All right. Well, we will take you guys. And, you know, with my disciple Bible study, I say, but we're going to start on time. Just because we don't want to keep everybody waiting, but there is no, you know, I'd far rather have you walk in late than not come at all. So I'm just thankful. I'm amazed how people with families can get anywhere on time, because I remember those days. So if we can find there is a sheet there for you, and there's two of them actually in two of these. Good. So we are talking about, however, this what your role is in worship. If the common understanding is not right, does anybody have a guess what the Presbyterian understanding might be? I'll give you a hint. It has a lot to do with the audience. Who might, if it's not y'all, who might actually be the audience of worship? Anybody want to just think about it? God! Exactly. The audience of worship is God. So it takes you guys out of the Siskel and Ebert role of saying, Pastor must have had a busy week this week. That sermon was a little thin. Or, the choir was really fabulous this week. I loved that anthem. The audience is God. We are giving ourselves to God, we're receiving from God in worship. So then, who are the actors?
Congregation.
The congregation. You are the actor. And the pastors and the choir, we are in the role of prompting. Prompting your worship. Do you see how that completely changes our understanding of worship? You need to come trusting that God is going to speak to you on a given day. You need to prepare your hearts. When we had that call to worship, that is you all intent. Come on in. We're glad you're here. Be ready to meet God. When you sing, whether you like the tune or not, whether you think it's singable or not, it is a prayer to God. That's huge. So worship is active. It is not passive. I will tell you one of the things that Patrick may have mentioned this actually last week. Sometimes he does. One of the things that is kind of annoying is people will talk about, well, I left that church because I wasn't being fed there. That's pretty passive, isn't it? Are you, you know, when it comes to food, do you just like go, okay? No, we participate. We make it happen, right? So our role as Christians is to be proactive, active. in our discipleship, not to be spoon-fed. So really, really important. All right, so Presbyterian worship is all about God. God is at the center of it. And I want you to look. You should have, and if you don't have one in front of you, this bulletin is our old worship bulletin. We've changed the format, but I continue to use this one because this was an unusual Sunday, and we haven't had a Sunday like this before. So let me just run through these aspects of Presbyterian worship. It's all about God. In other words, if God is the audience, everything is centered around God. It's biblically informed. Scripture is central, but we don't attach a Bible, a verse, to everything we do. It's highly intentional. It focuses on community. Chuck, that's what you were bringing up. You'll notice that many of the hymns are we hymns rather than I and me hymns. It demonstrates and it lifts up the unity of the body of Christ. And it's a springboard that sends us out into the world. So I want you to take a look, take a few minutes, and maybe gather with somebody around you, just for a couple minutes, and look at this and see how might our bulletin live out these principles that you're seeing. Can you look at it? And just look at it like with fresh eyes and say, what is this bulletin? How can we see that it's centered on Scripture? That it's we-oriented instead of me-oriented, that it's intentional. So just take a few minutes, take a gander at it, and just see what you notice looking at it, the bulletin fresh.
Looks like I'm going to be the only one to jump in here, but I got a loud mouth. The only thing that I've noticed about the bulletin doesn't disturb me, but it's a different aspect because, well, case in point, yesterday we had a chance to visit a friend here in McKinney, one of the hospitals, had most of his foot taken out because of diabetes. And we talked a little bit about it yesterday, but the thing that's getting him through it is prayer. And previously, in my past life, most of the Presbyterian churches that we did belong to had a place in the bulletin to force you to take your mind off the everyday and pray for Mary Jones and Tom, Smith, so that you were thinking, and having gone to a great deal of surgery myself, I know there's a heck of a lot of power in prayer, but most of us kind of say, I don't want to pray for these people, But prayer is strong, and I that's why I always like the bulletin that listed, this week. Now, you always leave somebody on too long, and you always get somebody new that doesn't need to be on. But anyway, but that was always a strong point in terms of the bulletin. That's the only thing that jumped out at me when I first saw this.
Let me just show you after worship where our prayer list is.
I do know, but
yeah, okay.
but you don't, when you go into the into the sanctuary, you don't go out here to a bulletin board. You have it right in front of you while you're sitting there saying prayers, and I think that's just a lot stronger thing.
We have competing needs. We're trying to use paper,
I know,
efficiently, but prayer is nonetheless central to our worship. But I hear your point, Chuck, on that. Be good. There's a lot of things we wish we could put in the bulletin. Okay, anybody else want to lift up anything that you see that connects to what these central things about worship are?
Your bulletin to me is very interactive, and now I guess I'm cheating because I've been coming to church for a while here, so I've seen it, but you never fail to have members of the body, either during the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's just very interactive. It's not just the choir or the pastor, not that those aren't important, which they are, but I see it as very interactive, I mean,
so we
including just the greeting, just the greeting time.
The greeting time, yep. You could try
incorporate
it.
The children.
Always,
you do all. There's so many aspects to this church.
That, Alex, those are, and one of the things is the intentionality. Those are all things that we get the children in worship, that we greet one another, that we have various people involved in worship. Yeah, good. How about Scripture? Do you see the centrality of Scripture?
In Old terms Testament, of, New Testament.
We have certainly, we have. And one thing, as we've gone to the shorter bulletin that I missed, I love the way this used to be set up, where, do you notice how it says, the first movement of the worship service is preparing for the Word. The second is proclaiming the Word. Then the last part is responding to the Word. Although this Sunday we sealed the Word. We'll talk more about what that is. So it's a flow, and that flow is still there, even though we don't have room to, that it is preparing, then receiving the Word, the written Word and the proclaimed Word, and then being sent out. Good. Well, look at these central things and ponder that as you go into worship today and see what else you see. All right. We tend in worship, if you'll flip your sheet over, to fall in between high church, a more, you know, a Catholic, an Episcopal, and lower church of a Bible church. We're right in the middle. So we're often a good meeting ground for mixed marriages of a Baptist and a Catholic, because there's enough in our liturgy that somebody who comes from a Catholic or Episcopal tradition recognizes worship, but we're not so formal that somebody comes from a less formal tradition just feels completely like, I don't know when to stand up or sit down or what to do. So we're right in the middle there. The essential elements of worship are listed there: prayer, Scripture, the sacraments, self-offering, relating to each other in the world. I always like to ask, is there something missing from this list that is really important to people's decisions about where they worship that you can see? It often drives people's church decision. You think? What's not there? This isn't the Bible. It's a hymnal. Isn't this one there? That's weird. Music isn't a central element of worship? You know why it's not listed? Because music, again, this goes back to our understanding of worship, is not separate. All of our music is understood as prayer. All of our music is a form of prayer. So it's never performance, it's prayer. When you're singing congregationally, that is a prayer. When the choir is doing an anthem, that is a prayer on behalf of the congregation. So music as prayer. Isn't that interesting? I do want to talk a second about music and worship. Did Patrick talk? I wasn't here for Patrick. Okay. So in terms of our music, this church used to have a contemporary service and a traditional service, and they changed it just before I came here, actually, and came to a philosophical decision that we are going to, we didn't want to have separate congregations. We wanted to have one congregation that worshiped at two times, and we wanted our music to, when we chose our music on any given Sunday, we were choosing what would best enhance, accompany, drive home the Word of God that was being preached that day. Our endeavor is to have a music that is mixed, that we have, that it, you know, has a variety of musical styles each week. We tend to practically kind of tip toward the more traditional. But that is more practical in that we have not yet unearthed, you know, to have a, what's the term I'm trying to think of? It's not mixed. It's just escaping me. We're, you know, music.
Okay, blended.
Blended. Thank you. Thank you very much. Blended is the word. We are wanting to find more people who are willing to share their musical gifts with us in a variety of styles. And we're working on growing the more contemporary portion of what we do. But you will hear, you know, a variety of instruments. Today we have our wonderful Trinity Orchestra playing and our praise kids. We heavily lean on this hymnal. Most of the songs, whenever you see the songs up there in with notes on the screen, that means it came from our hymnal. We lean heavily on this, but the hymnal is a really diverse group of songs. It has praise songs in it. It has things from all over the world, which we love. So if you have musical abilities.
I've caught your subliminal.
Yeah, okay. and I'm sure we would love to have you share those with us in
Mally?
Yes, sir.
Along those same lines, let me ask you a question. I don't know what the standing is on it, but we've been in some Presbyterian churches where the idea of applause for performance of
anything. Thank you. I do want to talk to that. I will speak to that exactly.
Then I won't say anything.
Okay. Yeah, that's it. We have some folks who come from a more effusive worship background that a part of their worship is to respond in applause, in amens, in hallelujah. We had a wonderful parish assistant here, an African-American gentleman who tried to get us frozen chosen more, to become more responsive. That is an important part of the Christian tradition. Then there is another branch of the family tree, and many Presbyterians feel strongly about this, that in light of what we talked about, that worship is not performance, they are anti-applause because they feel like it makes it feel more like a performance. Yes.
Growing up, I mentioned Leslie. Leslie was raised in the Nazarene Church, which is a sect of the Methodist. And I grew up, and it was more traditional, and then it kind of transformed into a more contemporary. And there were a lot of folks who didn't appreciate the applause after any kind of performance of any sort. And so one thing that we ended up, the church ended up trying to explain was, it's not so much an applause of the performance, but it's an applause as a form of praise to God for the thing that was just done.
Right, thankfulness.
I agree.
Yeah.
Totally.
So, here's the deal, guys. If you are a pro-applause person, have at it. If that makes you uncomfortable, it's okay to not. And the choir won't think, oh, I guess they didn't like it. Again, we are a church that is in the middle. And so if worship is your responding to God, you respond in the way that you are comfortable with. And you're going to have grace with people around you who do it differently. And isn't that the name of the game? And how rare is that in our culture? How wonderful if we can be a place where we're comfortable with different. And we celebrate that. So feel free to applaud. Feel free to not.
I don't want to say tradition, but the structure of the Presbyterian Church. But in my experience with churches and in worship, music worship, because I think all facets of worshiping God worship, I think there is and I hope I'm not getting in trouble here. No. I think there is a spiritual bondage a lot of times in churches and in bodies of people that seek God and that call themselves Christian, that are Christian on whatever level in their journey. And I think spiritual bondage in worship is dangerous. You know, I've been in a church before, and they're just so stiff and tight. And I don't think it was the formal. I think God showed me it wasn't their formal structure. They didn't feel free to worship Him, and it's heartbreaking to me. You know, I mean, I think formal is beautiful. I did have to struggle with your choir a little bit, but I learned a trick, which made me late today. I worship music, getting ready for church and driving in, and then I'm ready for everything else. So, you know.
We come from different backgrounds.
There's a lot of diversity in this church here.
Yeah, beautiful. Good. I'm going to move us on because this is a great conversation. I'm supposed to cover worship and polity. I do want to bring up one other thing that comes up. Read about our sacraments. We have two. And the reason I wanted to share this with you is both of them happened on that day. What are our two sacraments?
Baptism and
communion. And we'll talk more about those at some point in the future. I also want to mention the clerical collar. Some Presbyterian churches have the pastors wear clerical collars. Some do not. Our choice to do that here is because Patrick is an eminently practical man. And he says to himself, I want people who are visiting the church to know which one the pastor is. It's a pretty good clue, isn't it? So we wear the clerical collars on Sunday. If you see me at Kroger or out at the vet or wherever, probably be in something, in my sweatsuit or whatever. But that's so that on Sunday morning or whenever we're doing something pastoral, you know, people can recognize. So you can look at some of those other terms. All right, polity. Oh, my gosh, I have not done a good job of. But the good news is next week we've got a little bit of wiggle room. So we'll just do what we can do today, and I'll shorten up some things next week. So Presbyterian polity is a fancy way for saying the way that we govern ourselves. And as Rebecca shared with you the first week, what does the word Presbyterian mean? Do you remember?
Elders.
Ruled by graybeards, ruled by elders. So actually the name of our denomination comes from the biblical way that we govern ourselves. So let's see what is distinct about that. I am going to let you read on your own the principles that govern the way we govern ourselves. And I think one of the most important things, number 7, is really, really critical, though they're all important. Shared leadership is very important. I always can tell people are not from a Presbyterian background if they come and visit and they say, well, yes, Pastor, no, Pastor, well, whatever you say, Pastor, and I go, ooh, you're coming from a tradition that has a pastor who is kind of placed on a pedestal, who's kind of like the CEO. If they get a vision, if the pastor gets a vision for the church, then they tell whatever the board of elders is or whatever, and then they tell the congregation, and that's the way you go. By the way, if you like to go see plays and you want to see a really interesting play on that, I think it's still at the Dallas Theater Center, there's a play called The Christians. It's
the what?
The Christians. Provocative, troubling, but it deals with leadership and that whole thing. That's all I'll say about that, but really good. Okay, so we are truly ruled by elders. We, Patrick and I, when we gather to make decisions with our elders, we have a vote, but our vote counts no more than anyone else. It's shared leadership. Very, very important. Okay, we have a constitution that I mentioned. It is comprised of 2 documents. The first one is our Book of Confessions. And this is so cool. I have a fellow who joined the church about a year ago who's reading this Book of Confessions and reading about it, and he's like, oh my gosh, why don't we talk about this more? This is such good stuff. So what the Book of Confessions has in it is it has a number of different documents that were written at various times in church history when the church was struggling with what does it look like to be a Christian in this time and in this place. We think right now that we're probably the first people that have ever struggled with what does it look like to be a Christian now, with the things that our culture and our country are wrestling with. Christians have been wrestling with that since Jesus was resurrected, but we've wrestled with different things. So the earliest Christians wrestled with, who is this Jesus guy who just left us in the lurch here and we're kind of making our way and we don't have scriptures put together yet, and how does he relate to God? And so the earliest confessions are dealing with who is Jesus? Who is God? Who is this Spirit? And oh my gosh, what is this Trinity thing? The word Trinity doesn't appear in Scripture, but they worked it out and realized, oh my gosh, we have one God in 3 persons that are in relationship with one another. So that's what the earliest ones are dealing with. Later confessions are dealing with other things. There's one called the Barman Declaration from Germany that I love. The German church, during the rise of Hitler, one of the ways that Hitler got the church under control in Germany so he was free to do what he wanted to do, to have his agenda with the nation, was he met with the German Christian leaders and he said, look, you guys have absolute sovereignty over the life of the church. I will leave you guys alone to do your churchy thing. But God has appointed me to be the sovereign ruler of this nation, and you guys stay out of my business, and I will stay out of yours. And the German church went, that sounds good, because Hitler said, I have been appointed by God to make this nation great. We've been downtrodden by other nations. Just let me do my thing and don't interfere, okay? And the German church said, okay, good. But there were a few German Christians who said, isn't Jesus supposed to be Lord of all? Doesn't that mean that Jesus is Lord over every aspect of our lives? Well, if so, then that impacts every area, and we as Christians should be involved in the life of the world and the nation. And so they wrote this document called the Barman Declaration, which they wrote at great risk to defy Hitler in this, to say, wait a minute, Jesus Christ is Lord of all. I love the Barman Declaration and the courage it took. to write that document. Then we have some newer documents that are dealing with, well, what does it mean to be a Christian? How, you know, when we began to think about women and women in leadership. So there's some that address women in leadership when we began to wrestle and say women can be leaders in the church. When we began to struggle with war and when is war the right thing, and when, so there are confessions that deal with that. With our stewardship of the environment, that's something we've been awakened to as Christians. So there are those. The newest one, we just added one, and that doesn't happen very often at all, but we added one that I love. It's the first confession of faith to come from the Southern Hemisphere. It's the Belhar Confession. It comes from South Africa and their struggles with apartheid and the equality of all and justice for all. So these are beautiful documents that we can go to and learn from Christians in different times and different places as they struggle with what it means to be a Christian here and now. What does it look like to be faithful given what we know, what we're going through? And
a lot of scholars.
You know what? I'm going to stop because she's on a schedule, and we're going to cut her off in just a minute, and I want to give her time
to
finish.
I'll talk to you, Chuck.
Okay, yeah, because a lot of scholars say there are too many confessions, and some of them are so deep you can't even understand them in today's language.
Yeah, and it takes some learning and thinking. Yep. Okay, so I'm going to talk about one thing today, and then we'll finish up our polity next week, but I do want to talk about one thing today. On the order of struggling with what does it look like to be a Christian today? We are in an age where people are, we've forgotten how to disagree agreeably. There's a lot of strong conversation in a lot of different directions, particularly if you get on Facebook and you're not looking somebody in the eye as you're talking to them. And so then people start screaming at each other, and even Christians have disagreements publicly that are painful. So I want to address one issue that our culture is presently struggling with, and people have strong feelings one way or another about it, and that is the issue of sexuality and inclusion in the life of the church. I will have people often come, and they'll visit the church once, or before their visit, they'll call me and they'll say, I'd like to, before I worship here, I'd like to know, I'd like to visit with you, I'd like to know, you know, where you guys are on this, anyway, they don't say why, but they'll come in, and invariably, it'll be two issues. One, do you use the King James Bible? For some reason, for folks, it isn't a real church unless you use the King James Bible, and we're struck out on that one. I say, sorry, sometimes we do, but it's not, we don't think that's the only Bible there is, and you have a better sense of that, of why, because of what Rebecca shared with you last week. The second one, of course, is the issue of sexuality and where are you on inclusiveness there. Our denomination I'll explain the polity behind this a little bit more next week, but when we gathered with elders and pastors at a meeting made the decision for full inclusion of LGBTQ folks in the church. That means that should they be approved by their presbytery, they can become pastors, and pastors may marry same-sex folks, and that decision was made after much prayer, much conversation, much study of scripture. So 5 years ago, that decision was made by the Presbyterian Church USA. Some churches have left for out of disagreement of that issue. We are here by choice because we are comfortable in our understanding of the gospel that all are welcome. So we do want to make you all aware of that. That said, we have folks within this body who are who don't agree with that, and they are welcome here. As long as they are comfortable with making all feel welcome. It's not acceptable to not be kind to folks, but you're certainly allowed to have your opinion anywhere along the spectrum. We have many folks who have LGBTQ loved ones, and we have gay members. So all are truly welcome wherever you are on the spectrum, uh, and and would love to have further conversation with anyone who has questions about that or thoughts or concerns. But I do want to make that, you know, clear to you all. So, okay, I have gone over by 5 minutes. I'm so sorry. I will pick up more polity. And let me say also that I don't know if Patrick said this, but Patrick and I and Rebecca, one of our greatest joys is to go out for coffee and have conversation or to have you come into the office and have conversation. So about anything I've shared or anything else, call, email, text, say let's get together and let's talk. Would love to do that. So, okay. All you,
Melanie. Thank you, Melanie. So for those of you